Hello, everyone. Welcome to GIS Tokyo Book Week. I am Samuel, the librarian at GIS Tokyo Nishikasai Campus. And before we start with our program, I would like to invite our principal, Mrs. Maduma, to address the gathering.
Thank you, Samuel. Konnichiwa, namaste, and good afternoon from GIS Tokyo. I welcome you all to the Book Week celebrations at our campus. It's my honor and privilege to have amongst us an iconic leader, Ms. Sudha Murthy. Her presence is of a special significance. Ms. Sudha Murthy is a noble teacher and a fine writer who has inspired thousands to serve the society and inculcate the right values. I'm sure our students and parents at GIS Tokyo and across the world, from GIS Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Singapore campuses, India campuses, and Malaysia campuses, will feel greatly honored and encouraged that they get to interact with Ms. Sudha Murthy today. Dear Madam, it's a great honor and privilege to have you amidst us, and I take this pleasure to welcome you. For those who don't know, we are celebrating 20 years of Global Schools Foundation this year. In a recent AGM 2021 in November, we had the privilege to hear from Mr. Narayan Murthy, who is a patron with Global Schools Foundation, about his vision of GIS in next future years. We're very privileged to have amongst us Ms. Murthy and Mr. Narayan Murthy's guidance for all of us at GIS. May I now invite our student MCs, Joanne and Adya, to begin the proceedings for Audu's visit today. Over to Joanne and Adya. Thank you all.
Good afternoon, one and all. I am Joanne, and this is my classmate, Adya. And on occasion of the Book Week celebrated in our school, we are honored to welcome Mrs. Sudha Murthy for a virtual question and answer session here at Global Indian International School, Japan.
Ours is an Indian international school in Edogawa, a ward located in east of Tokyo and a part of the Global Indian International School network. At GIS Tokyo, we count with different curricula, CBSE, IGCSE, Cambridge Lower Secondary, and IB Diploma for secondary students. Whereas for the primary years, we have CBSE and IB PYP and Global Montessori for preschool. Ours is a dynamic educational framework aimed at fostering all-round development for students through an integrated and holistic approach to learning.
Every year during the last 5 days of the term, just before we break up for our winter holidays, at GIS Tokyo, we hold a series of activities that celebrate books, reading, and literature. This is what we call Book Week. During this special time, the love for books is almost tangible in the school, and the entire campus is engaged with audiovisual book materials and plenty of opportunities to read and exchange books. We'd like to share with you a brief overview of last year's Book Week through a short video.
Chapter 1, Hairy Faces. Chapter 1, Hairy Faces.
Frogs love water. This one was having a good time.
When Mrs. Twit came to, the frog had just jumped onto her face. This is not a nice thing to happen to anyone in bed at night. She screamed again.
By golly, it is a giant skilly-wiggler, Mr. Twit said. It'll bite off your nose.
He made an incredible discovery.
Conversion of water into food.
No! It really works!
This year, coinciding with the 20th anniversary of Global Schools Foundation, we have expanded and improved the program for the Book Week 2021 that we open today with this author's visit, for which we count with the kind participation of India's favorite storyteller, a prolific writer in both English and Kannada, Mrs. Sudha Murthy.
Mrs. Sudha Murthy is an Indian engineering teacher and an author in both English and Kannada. She is the chairperson of the Infosys Foundation and a member of public healthcare initiatives of the Gates Foundation. Mrs. Sudha Murthy has penned more than 35 books and more than 200 titles to her credit. Her published works include novels, short stories, technical books, travel logs, and children's books. Some of her most popular books include How I Taught My Grandmother to Read, Dollar Bahu, Here, There, and Everywhere, Magic Drum and Other Favorite Stories, and The Bird with Golden Wings. In 2021, she has published three new books, The Gopi Diaries, Finding Love in January, How the Earth Got Its Beauty in July, and The Sage with Two Horns that just came out last month.
Her books have been translated into all major Indian languages and have sold over 3 million copies overall. Her work has been appreciated and accepted by younger and older audiences alike. And she has quite the formidable fan following. Without further ado, we would now request Mrs. Sudha Murthy to speak a few words to our students.
Hi. Hi, everyone. Can you see me?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, hello. Hi. Hi, children. Can you see me?
No, ma'am. We can't see you.
Okay. Now, let me see.
Hi, ma'am. I think you can start your video now. We will be able to see you.
Can you see me now? No. No, you cannot start your video because host has stopped it. Open it for me.
Oh, sure. Yes, it's open.
Okay. Let me see that one because I'm earlier than my schedule, I suppose. Can you see me now?
Yes, can I see? I can see you.
Hello. But I can't see. Hi, children, can you see me? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, but I can't see my image here. Okay, doesn't matter, doesn't matter. You all can see me, you know, that's more than enough. More than enough. Ah, now I can see myself, yeah. Yes, girls? Shall we start?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I can't see you people now. Okay. Then let's have. Why can't you have a gallery view so that you can see everyone? Can make it a gallery view? Then I'm happy. Because I want to see you people. Though this session is from Tokyo. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Actually, I want to tell you, hi, girls. Hi, boys. It's nice that you have called me. And I want to tell you a very funny thing. Actually, I'm related to Japanese. Can you imagine? My brother is married to a girl from Tokyo.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Her name is Hiromi Komiya. Hiromi Komiya. So I have visited Tokyo many times in the last many years because my nieces are half Japanese, half Indian. Okay. What is that? Gudaimasta. That is thank you. Thank you. What is that? Tell me what to say for thank you. Arigatou. And I knew some of the Japanese song. Chi sana madukaita. You know, kawaii, madukaita. All those things. Now I've forgotten that. Okay, I used to sing for my niece who is half Japanese. So I have a Japan connection, and particularly Tokyo. So I'm really happy. This is an India school, if I'm not mistaken. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
You have a CBSE syllabus?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So your parents are posted here for some time or a long time, and then you do your CBS and come back to India or something that kind, or join Japanese university. What is your way of learning there?
Both the cases exist, ma'am.
Both are okay. Okay, I read 4 books of yours. Someone else. Okay. Have you read any book of mine?
Yes, ma'am, a lot.
A lot. Chalo, let's have fun now. My sessions are always fun. It is not like, you know, a big lecture or something. We'll have fun sessions. Now tell me, do you want to ask me questions? That will be a fun game. If anybody wants to ask questions, then I will answer. That is better than me giving you a sermon. You have a lot of sermons at home as well as in college, in school. So let us have some new friend has come and we'll have fun session. How do you think so?
Sure, ma'am. We actually have a lot to know from you. So we'll have a few questions from students later. But the two of us want to know a few things from you. So starting with, can we know how a normal day in Sudhamurthy's life looks like?
Okay. Actually, I'm a very, very, very busy person. The reason is, writing is a full-time job. Foundation is a full-time job. So I do 2 full-time jobs. And when you do 2 full-time jobs, then you have to be super efficient. And knowing Japanese culture, they are very, very efficient people. Okay. So I get up in the morning. I will either in the morning or in the evening, I walk for an hour. It is a must for me, 1 hour walk. Okay. Either I walk in the morning or in the evening, depending on what. Sometimes I get calls in the morning, international calls. So I can't say no. Then next one is I do yoga. For 25 to 30 minutes. Okay, that's always in the morning, not in the evening. Then I have a dog by the name Gopi. You must have known about Gopi a lot. Have you seen Gopi's book?
Yes, sir.
Gopi Diaries. So yes. I spend 15 minutes with Gopi in the morning. I will have conversation with Gopi. You know, Gopi says, I want this, or I think so. I play with him. That is my tonic, 15 minutes a day, immediately in the morning. Then, of course, I'll have my bath, everything. Then a little bit of household work. I have a cook, but I have to tell what is people are there. I have to tell the menu, etc. Then I set off to office by 8 or 8:15. Once I'm in office, I forget the world because we do get 400 emails a day. We get physical emails. Then there are always Zoom calls. Then there are always webinars. So up to 12:30, my house is 5 minutes from the office. So 12:30 up to 12:30, I work. After 12:30, I go home and have quick lunch in 10-15 minutes, spend about 15 minutes with my husband. 1 o'clock, I'm back. Again, 1 to 5, I work. And all days I work. Saturday, Sunday also, you know, I like to go back. There is nobody. So I prefer to sit and work alone. I can do a lot more work. So Then I travel a lot. Because of pandemic, I don't travel now. Otherwise, all weekends I used to travel. So this is the way I spend time. I hardly attend somebody's wedding, wedding anniversary, birthday parties. Very, very rare. I don't do much of socializing because I really don't get time. Tell me now.
That seems like such a tight schedule.
Yeah, I have very tight.
Very tight. How do you find motivation to keep doing this? Like every single day, no break at all?
Because there are one thing, you know, I always believe, maybe with the age I have learned, when I look at poor people, I always feel I have a duty towards them. I have a duty towards them because God has given more than my plate can hold. So I have a great sense of duty towards poor people, and that is my motivation to work for foundation.
That's so true. That's very inspiring, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, moving on to the author Sudhamurthy, we would like to know how your journey has been of your evolution as an author.
Okay, I will tell you. When I was a young girl, you know, I studied in a language known as Kannada. Anybody knows Kannada in your school? Anyone knows Kannada? Raise your hand. What's your name, beta?
My name is Adya.
Adya Rao.
Adya.
I saw somebody Rao also. I saw Kannada is my mother tongue. Some Kulkarni there, Akshash Kulkarni. I was a Kulkarni before my marriage. Okay, some Gopal, was it Lakshari Gopal? Okay, many people are. Kannada is the language of the state of Karnataka, and I'm born and raised there. So, my mother tongue is Kannada, and I learned 70, I'm now 71. About 60 years back, it was a Kannada medium school. So I learned every subject in Kannada. And when my mother was a school teacher before her marriage, and she always was a school teacher to me throughout my life. So she told me, whenever I used to visit, you know, I come from a middle class family. My father was a doctor. We are not very rich people at all, actually. So whenever there is a holiday, my mother will take us to monuments, history monuments. She was a history teacher. My grandfather was also a history teacher. So I know history fairly well. She used to take us some monuments and we'll enjoy it, take our lunch, eat everything and come back. Yes, Devi Pyasiri. I know Kannada. Thank you, Beta. Thank you. I'm happy. So I used to come back and my mom will tell, how was the picnic? We said, oh, it was very nice, very nice. Then she will tell, okay, then you write over 25 lines what you have seen today. As a kid, 8-9 years old, I used to say, no, writing is boring. I won't write. She said, fair enough, then there's no dinner. So she made it compulsory that we have to write what we see. And I used to really get upset with her. I said, why we have to write? We enjoyed there. We went there. We had picnic. And she said, no, what you have seen, even picnic also you should write. So it became compulsory for me to write 25 lines when we go out and come back. Sometimes I said, I will not come for a picnic because I have to write. She said, okay, fair enough. I will drop you at home and all of us will go. The result of that, I said, no, I don't want to stay alone because there is a lot of nice things in a picnic. Then I started writing. While I started writing, I realized how beautiful it is to write your experience. How it is beautiful to imagine, like, you see a temple which is 2,500 years old. What would have been 1,500 years old? This temple would have been, it should have been a vibrant temple, right? Vibrant. It may not be today. So I went on imagining and started writing how it would have been there and how my, you know, how to write. So many times we did not go for a picnic, but this habit remained with me. Suppose there's a beautiful rain one day. I would enjoy rain and I read how beautiful the rain was. How the flowers were shivering in the rain. How the leaves were enjoying in the rain. That is what I could feel and I could imagine that. So this became my habit of writing, imagining and writing. Then in school and class, I used to write fairly very good essays. How I spent my holiday. Everybody will write, I went to grandmother's place, we ate chapati, we ate mango, we came back, we had a good fun. No, I would write differently. When I went there, what I felt it about a holiday. There's no homework. There's nobody to supervise because I have my granny. So looking at all those things, I said, I will write the way I connected with my grandmother. How she she taught me. When like coming back after the holiday, I was feeling very sad to leave her. So this is how I developed my habit of writing and going from one level to another level. When I was in a teenage, like all of you, 15, 16, I started writing a little bit more than that. I knew about Kipling. So I wrote about Rudyard Kipling, who wrote If is a very beautiful poem. Someone read and I understood it. Then he says, not everyone is a man. Then only, sir, I will call you. You are a man. I really like that. Then I wrote about Mozart, I remember. And I sent it to the paper. I must have been 15 years old. Because Kannada people were not aware of Mozart. So I wrote what Mozart means to us and why he was so famous, etc. They gave me 5 rupees as a royalty for my writing. That was my first earning in life. My first earning was 5 rupees. And everybody wanted, we should have a party, etc. I said, no. I said, I will buy a book. Okay? Book of general knowledge. And about 17, 18, I will write once in a while like this something. And I will get some money and then celebrate it. Once I bought a skirt for my sister. Once I brought a blouse, a velvet blouse for my other sister. So I used to share. I know that. Because I learned sharing is caring. Sharing is caring. Which in Gopi's diary also I say, sharing is caring. We are 4 children. And once I joined engineering, then I did not write much. Because there was no time. It was all, and I was the only girl in engineering college. I was the only girl in the university. That is year 1968. Before your parents were born, I thought.
Yes.
So I became extremely busy. And I did not have time to write, think and write. Imagine and write. No, I couldn't create much. Once I got my job, then I started, I traveled on my backpack to America in the year 1978 or 79 early, okay? And it was very unusual journey. Now you people travel, but I traveled in 1979 with very, very little money, I traveled on a backpack. It was my first journey out of country. It was my first aeroplane journey as well. I never enjoyed the aeroplane. I never got into aeroplane until I was 29. Okay. So I felt what I saw, I wrote. And that became a book from beyond Atlantic or something that kind in Canada. And that gave me a strength. Look, I'm not even a literature student, but I can write and it can be published. And thus, my journey of writing in Canada started by the year 1979. And it is there even today. But very funny thing is I started writing in English after the age of 50. I always used to think I am very good in Kannada, let me write. George, TJS George, or the editor of Indian Express, he told me, Sudha, you have traveled so much in life, and why can't you write? I said, my English may not be great, my vocabulary is not great, I'm a very ordinary person. He said, most people are ordinary. In India, people who speak English are not extraordinary. Their vocabulary is not extraordinary great. And for them, you should write. And I started writing columns in Indian Express. And my first book came in the year, when I was 51, I started writing in English. Or maybe after 50. 50 or 2 months. November 12th of 2080. Okay. My first book came in 2002. I was 52 years old. That is Wise and Otherwise. And thus, my English writing started. The advantage of writing in English is so many people will read. Your readership will be multiplied by 1 million times than Kannada. Kannada, very few people will read. Now, a lot of people read. And it was translated in 13 Indian languages within a year. So now I have 250 titles and I have 40 books. This is my journey of literature.
That's amazing, ma'am.
Yeah. What is the total duration for this session, Peter? Children, tell me.
Ma'am, it's 1 hour, actually. It's
okay, no problem. I know, number one, I'm very friendly with children. Number two, I can imagine myself in your shoes when I was young. Okay, so I should have more patience. Now tell me next one.
Ma'am, we have heard about
your... Now you tell me your name.
Ma'am, my name is Suraj.
So, Suraj?
Yes.
Suraj.
Suraj.
And your name?
I'm Kirtana.
Kirtana, because it's only team A and team B. I said, no, not anonymous. I want, you should tell your name. Tell me, Suraj.
Ma'am, now that we have heard about your career in writing, we'd like to hear some interesting things that happened during your life when you were a child.
Well, many things actually happened. I'm like a regular, normal child, you know. When I was 8 or 9 years old, there used to be a Dasara festival in our colony. So there used to be an elocution competition. So my mother said, why can't you speak? Then she helped me. She wrote actually and gave it to me. And, you know, I by heart it. And, you know, the moment I went to stage, near stage, I was so scared to talk because I was only 9 years old. Imagine. And I turned back to my father and asked him, how will I speak? There are so many people sitting here. I'm only 9 years girl. My father said, but he was a professor and a doctor. He told me, please think, every head is a stone. Stones don't answer. So you are addressing to stones. So when you address to stones, you'll be natural. You'll smile. You'll make joke. You don't get scared. Okay. The moment you are facing people, what they will comment, they will laugh, you're worried. Assume they are stones. And even though they laugh, the stone is laughing, you should think. Okay? So, assume they are stones and you go up. I went up and I knew what my lecture is or my speech was. And every blackhead, I consider them as a stone. And I spoke without the note because I knew the content. Without that note, I became extemporaneous and I spoke. Why the note was the importance of Dasara in Karnataka, because Karnataka is famous for Dasara. It started in Vijayanagara Empire in 1336. Then it's the Mysore Empire and now it's the state of Karnataka. So we have 700 years. At that time, it was 650 years. History of Dasara. Dasara is indicating so many things. And for us, it's the festival of Karnataka. So I was so natural. And I came back and my father said, it's an excellent job you have done. That helped me in real life. Even today, I am always an extempore speaker. I never prepare. Because number one, I speak with my heart open. Okay. Second thing, I don't lie. So I don't have to remember. If you lie, you should remember. Who last time what a lie I told? One time before what lie I told? Now I don't remember at all. So I remember what I have to tell through my heart. I connect my brain to my heart through my tongue. It's a very important lesson I learned when I was a kid. Yes, Beta. Ask me next one.
Yes, ma'am.
Kirtana.
Now we have some of our friends who'd like to ask you a few questions on behalf of our school.
No problem.
Ma'am?
Yes. What is your name? You should tell me because I always like, children's name.
My name is Sarah.
Sarah. Okay, Sarah, beta. Tell me.
Ma'am, a student from grade 6 says, Mrs. Sudha Murthy, to achieve great heights like you have already managed, while still remaining humble, one has to have a great source of inspiration. That is why I would like to know more about your source of inspiration.
Inspiration. Okay. Sarah, it is not one person. You grow with time. You grow with ideas. You grow with people. Many people became inspiration when I was young. When I was very young, my grandfather was my inspiration. He was a Sanskrit scholar. He was a great teacher. So always I used to think, oh, nobody can beat my grandfather. He's so good. When I was a teenager, my father was my inspiration. He was a very famous professor and a doctor, the way he used to treat patients, etc. I said, nobody can beat my papa. Okay, but when I started my job, by the time I was 23, I said, not really one person. Every person is a flower. Every flower has its own beauty. So I can learn everything from small. I can learn from every person something. So I went on learning everything from everybody. And that became my source in my real life. Now, I don't have anybody, one person, but I have a bunch of persons. For example, I learned from you, Sara, that you are away from India, you are in Japan, language is different, okay? And you are learning two cultures in a very young age, Japanese as well as Indian. So it is so nice to be like that. So I feel it's so nice to be. Hum bhi agar bachche hote, naam hamara bablu bablu. You know that song? Khane ko milte hai laddu, aur dunya kehte hai happy birthday to you. Okay? Okay, beta.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Your mom is sitting there next to you?
Ma'am, actually, we are at school, so she's in the library.
Yes. Who is the person next to you?
Ma'am, our IT teacher.
Call her.
Namaste. Good afternoon, beta. Ma'am.
Good afternoon. What's your name?
My name is Jayanti. Huh. I'm working here as an IT teacher. I teach robotics and ICT.
Oh, it's very nice. Very nice. Uh-huh.
Nice to meet you,
you're
ma'am.
From which part of India? Thank you. You're
I'm from Tamil Nadu.
Okay. So have fun in school. School is a place where you should have a lot of fun. Okay?
That's true, ma'am.
Uh-huh. Enjoy, kids.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jayanti. Thank you. God bless you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Yes, Kirtana.
Thank yes, ma'am. So our next question will be posed by Aryam Karikalan from grade 6.
No problem for me. Anybody is fine. Hi. What a big boy I'm meeting now. Huh? Okay. Don't get scared. You're talking to your nanny, you feel. Yeah?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. What's your name, beta?
Aryam.
Aryam. Okay.
Aryam.
Aryan, okay.
Huh. A curious student from grade 4 asks the next question. Ma'am, what were you doing when you were in grade 3?
We used to play a lot of outdoor games. There was no computer in those time. Then we used to do running, climbing the trees. Okay, and enjoying the festivals with a lot of laddus and all. Okay, no calorie calculation, no homework. We had very little homework. And I know, I want to tell you a secret. I had 75 first cousins. How many? 75. So, we used to really enjoy. Holiday means every day is a joy, but holiday is more joy. We had a field and we had a garden. We had one talab and we'd take bath there. Fight at times, then cuddle, then sleep, then ask apologies. And we had dogs, we had a horse in the house, in the farm. So we were like any other normal children, but with no homework. Okay? No pressure.
That was very interesting to listen to, ma'am. Hope we had wonderful experiences like yours. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, beta. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. You want to ask something else? Ask. No problem.
Ma'am, I have no question, ma'am.
Okay. Fine. Next.
Ma'am, now we have Bhuvan Karthikeyan of grade 6 who would like to ask you some questions.
Hello, ma'am.
Okay, I want to ask you a question. No, 1 minute. I want to ask you questions for all of you. You are in Japan. How much Japanese do you know? Can you manage in a train all alone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I don't know that much, but I know like how to communicate a little bit.
Yeah, okay. You two bigger people, you can communicate well in Japanese?
Yes, ma'am. Fairly, okay.
So you take a train and travel anywhere in Japan?
Anywhere in Japan as such, not like Hokkaido, faraway places, but like nearby in Tokyo, we can.
We can take the train.
Okay. Yeah.
Train, no problem. Definitely. And how do you find, their alphabets are quite difficult compared to English alphabet, right?
Yes.
But you're able to talk, that is not a problem. Tell me, how all of you did you learn Japanese? Is it a part of the curriculum?
Yes, ma'am.
Japanese.
It's an option of our curriculum.
Yes.
I was a 16, 17 years, I think. We saw one very famous Japanese movie in India. That is Love in Tokyo. Love in Tokyo. Okay. And there is a song, Sayonara, Sayonara.
Yeah.
That word I know. To say bye, Sayonara.
Sayonara.
And I showed it to my brother's wife. Her name is Hiromi. She says Japan definitely is not like that because every Japanese is speaking Hindi in that movie. Okay. Okay. Better ask me the question.
Hello, ma'am. I've heard you read many books. What is the motivation to read so many books? Do you remember the first book you read as a child?
First book I won't remember. But, you know, we are in a village, a small village. And in 1962, up to 62, when I was 12 years old, until that there was no electricity. Okay? We have to read between sunrise to sunset. There was a kandi like that. And the only entertainment for us was stories and books. So we started reading in a very early age, young age, different books. Our village has a library. The library had a limited book. So I used to really get bored. The books are less. In that case, I will ask my grandparents, tell me some stories. So my earliest memory, what I remember is something in Ramayana or something I remember. Dasharatha had 3 wives and 4 children, and I never understood. I was maybe 5-6 years old. How 3 people can have 4 children, you know? Because I never understood that. That's what I remember, my earliest reading, okay, in Kannada. And I knew fairly well Sanskrit because it was spoken by my grandfather at home, so we knew Sanskrit. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Ma'am, anything else?
Ma'am, that was very interesting to listen to.
Yeah.
Hope we all feel more motivated to read.
You must read. I'll tell you, reading gives you, books are never failing friends. Never failing friends. If you don't have friends, friends will sometimes come, they won't come. But books are always with you. Second thing, books also is the source of knowledge. It's the best way to, when you travel. I every day, even today, I read about 150 pages nowadays. Okay, 150 pages I definitely read every day. Because without reading, I can't sleep. It's like a lullaby to me. I enjoy reading. I have a very fine library. One library is there for Kannada books. Another library is there for English books. And I care a lot for books. I cover, I look after them, clean them, dust them. I really care them like children, you know.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay.
Ma'am, moving on. Our next question is from Sakura Saha of grade 9.
Ma'am, this is a question that many students have asked. Consolidating, the question goes like this. Mrs. Sudha Murthy, it's a great honor to ask you a question. I have heard that you were the only woman engineer in college. What made you pursue engineering? Did anyone inspire you to take up engineering?
Okay, the answer is not anybody. I liked applied science. Any science, when you apply it, it becomes applied science. Applied science is the one which makes human life much better. For example, current is a pure science. Electricity is a pure science. The application of current or electricity is what we are living today. Okay. Logic is, calculation is pure science. But the application of computation is, you know, is computer, which is so much useful. So I was fond of applied science, and that is the reason I chose engineering, the year 1968. And it was not easy because I was the only girl in the university.
Ma'am, we would like to be as unique as you are. Thank you for being an example.
Thank you. When you want to achieve something, then you should give your 100% to that. I gave my 100% to engineering, and that's the reason I got a first rank.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Now, Sukruti Jain of grade 7 would like to ask a few questions.
The next question is one from the little ones, a grade 1. I'm very sure that it's going to bring a smile to your face.
What is the name of your superhero? What's the power of your superhero? And why is he your superhero?
Well, in a way, I consider Krishna as a superhero. Okay, Lord Krishna, because he was not after the kingdom. He was very intelligent person and he always went the right path, which we call dharma, right path. He helped people who were in difficulties, like he helped Draupadi, he helped Rukmini, he helped people who were in the right path. So for me, Krishna is the superhero.
That's very interesting, ma'am. Thank you.
Somebody is playing a piano. Lots of things. That's the one.
Sorry,
I want to say.
That's a school bell.
Oh, your school bell is a lots of things I want to say.
Huh. Oh,
I'm on my way. It is similar to I want to say My Fair Lady. It is similar to My Fair Lady's movie's music. Okay. Yes, beta.
Yes, ma'am. Up next, we have Arisa Pereira from grade 5.
Yeah. Who is the person in the school who has stayed longest time, in the sense LKG to 12th standard? 12 years, 10 years, 5 years, 7 years. Who is the person? How long you have stayed Kirtana?
Ma'am, I have been in the school for 7, 8 years now.
Okay, you are the senior most, I think.
No, ma'am. Saura? My classmates, Adi and Juan. Adi has been here for quite long. I think around more than 10 years in Japan. But in the school, around 10 itself.
Okay, when there is an international school competition, do you people go?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, we do.
And how many Japanese can understand good English?
Ma'am, since everyone's talking, all the Japanese are amongst Indians and people from other countries, everyone understands good amount of English.
Okay, fine. Huh. Ask me the question.
Ma'am, a student from grade 4 would like to know, how do you find a catchy title for your books?
So many people have asked me. Look at my books' titles, Wise and Otherwise. Okay? How I taught my grandmother to read. Then, A Man from the Egg, Upside Down King, A Sage with the Two Horns. Okay? How Onion Got Its Layers. Okay, how earth got its beauty, why sea became salty. All are very catchy. Will you agree?
Yes.
No, I take time and think over it. When the titles are catchy, then people like you will read. That's the reason we spend a little time on that. Not just you write and give. We think which attracts children to read. And such titles, we search and make them and write.
Yes.
Yeah.
I had never thought of that. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thanks.
The next question will be taken up by Mihika Hivarekar of grade 4.
I think I have a lot of fans for grade 4. Okay. Yes.
The next question is...
Do you speak Marathi at home?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. You're which part of India, your parents? Pune?
Pune, yes, ma'am.
Okay, better. Tell me.
The next question is from a student who is an avid reader. The student asks, ma'am, when did you realize that you were good at writing and it was one of your passions?
It's a really good question. I don't know that I'm good at it. I knew I enjoy writing. I knew I have a passion. Maybe around 30 years. When I was 30 years, I realized that I really enjoy writing. It is not because my mother told me to write. It is not because of the award I write. It is not because a book has to be published. No. I felt writing is my expression of my emotions. And the best way to let out my emotion is to write. I was around 30.
I love writing too, ma'am. I'm happy that I can relate to what you have shared with us.
Yeah. Please write. Go on writing. And then, you know, you'll excel in that, then you'll become very well. You should never write because somebody likes. You should never write because somebody enjoys. You should enjoy writing, then you'll be a good writer.
Thank you, Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Aila Namaskar Sang. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. My final question for the day is from Anushka Dawal.
Anushka. Okay, Anushka, my granddaughter's name is also Anushka.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. The next question is from a student in grade 7. Ma'am, why do you sometimes relate your stories with your life and the people you know?
How will I write, Anushka, about you? And in Japan, I do not know. I write about my own people whom I know and what I learned from them. Because I've been brought up in that area. If I write something which I do not know, I may not be authentic, no? To be authentic, I always describe about where I've been brought up, what language was spoken at home, and what are my feelings towards other people. I cannot import myself to Japan and write life in Japan. People will laugh at me because I really do not know anything in Japan, other than I was a tourist many years. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am. Great to know, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, apart from these, both of us have a few questions for you. Can we ask you?
Please ask.
Ma'am, you said that you went to Japan before. So what were some experiences you felt were surprising or particularly stuck out for you?
I will tell you. I went to Japan as early as 1992. Okay, and then many years also. Many times I have come to Japan and I have seen Honshu, Hokkaido, Shikoku, Kyushu, and many more places. I have seen quite a lot actually. Because we have a place to stay. Our sambandhis are there. So I learned a lot of Japanese things. Like they are extremely, honest, extremely honest. For example, you know, in those days, in 92 or something, many people did not know English, particularly in the railway station. Suppose I write something in English, because my sister-in-law wrote a lot of cards for me, which is this station, which is that station. And because I can't read Japanese, there is no English subtitle in those days. Now you may be having. So I show them something, where is this, which train I should take. That fellow who was going to office will drop everything and come to me, change the platforms and leave me there, which we don't do in India. Arey, udhar jao, left me right or corner pe hai jariye. Chalo, I have my work. They won't do like that. They're very honest. Second thing, I enjoy Japanese, some of the TV programs. Very famous one I saw for many years. What's her name? Oshin was the Japanese serial, which I thoroughly enjoyed for many years. In the year 1993-94, I suppose, long back, before you people were born. Then I saw Oshin also as a movie. Then my sister-in-law presented me Japanese detective novels, Points and Lines. They are fantastic. I always tell one thing you have to give me as a gift from Japan is Japanese detective books. Because they are so different than Indian detective. For example, Points and Lines, I will tell you. I started reading from Los Angeles, night flight, and I finished it until I reached India, 24 hours without eating anything because it was so attractive. And the tailor says, do you want anything? I said, no, I will only use the restroom. The rest I don't want. Points and Lines is such a beautiful thing. It is a story in Tokyo where there are 13 platforms. Have you read anyone of you read Points and Lines? There are many Japanese detective books which are in Japanese but not in English. So there are about few books are there. I can't tell his name because it's so difficult to pronounce. If any one of you can read Points and Lines in Japan, please read. And it is one of the most beautiful detective book or one of the most enchanting book I have ever read. Though I read a lot. The life, what happened, there are 13 platforms in Japan, in Tokyo Station. The murder, the two people get into the compartment at 5:30. Okay, that is the time there are always trains one after another, so nobody can see from platform 1 to platform 13 because there are always in between there are trains are there. At 5:13 to 5:15, 2 minutes, there are no trains from platform 1 to platform 13. And that time somebody sees a couple entering into a chamber, into a bogey at 5:40, and the rest is the story. Okay, I was thinking this will never happen in India because our trains will be delayed by 1 day, 10 hours, 8 hours, 6 hours, 4 hours, 2. And we are so much crowded, we don't even know who is next to me. Forget about 13th platform, let him getting in. Let him. The whole story is based upon these 2 minutes between 5:13 to 5:15, where platform 1 to platform 13, you can see people. And two people get into that, and the whole murder is revolved in that. I said, this is next to impossible in our country. Third thing I will tell you, I was traveling somewhere, I got into the bus, I paid thousands of yens, you know, we are not used to in India, we are used to, you know, in those days, 100 rupees, 200 rupees kind. Here some 25,000 yens, we don't give anyone 25,000 rupees also. So I gave some 50,000 yen or something that kind for my ticket, and the change would have was some 3,000 yen, and she didn't have, I said, fine, and I got into the bus. And when I came back in the evening, there was a lady who was waiting for me. In a cover, it was written 3,000, Mrs. Murthy, and she gave it to me and she went home. I asked her, why did you wait? She said, it's your money. And then I told her, how long it's time it takes? It's an hour. This lady, even after office hour, she waited for me, gave me the change and went. That is impossible, I can imagine. I said, this is not even a movie, this must be in the Mars. Okay. That I felt. There are many incidents that have happened to me in Japan like this, where I could not imagine it can happen in my life ever. Okay.
Yes.
And the safest place, it is one of the safest place for women to travel. 2 o'clock in the night, fine, I don't mind to take, because I know 2 o'clock in the night, Japan, if you are a woman, people will respect you a lot more and they won't even touch you. But in Delhi, I can't travel after 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
This is what. Yeah. Are they funny or are they real, or you felt I'm exaggerating?
Some of them, no, very real. Very interesting. It's very real. Like
one of the fantastic questions you have asked.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, apart from this, I wanted to know, as you have been writing for very long now, and all your stories are so interesting and gripping, I wanted to know how you actually keep on, get the flow of writing. Have there been instances where you've gotten a writer's block? And what do you do in such situations?
Normally, I write most of the time truth. My experiences, I write. For children, I have to imagine. And the whole thing will be ready in my mind. Then only I'll sit in front of the computer and start writing. It's not that I'll write 10 lines and then say, what is next? No, the entire plot will be ready in my mind. So my books, I write in 15 days. That doesn't mean I can write a book in 15 days. The writing is 15 days, but the conceiving, all that will be probably for a novel, I take 3 years. For a children book, maybe around 2.5-3 months. The whole story will be in my mind. I'll be thinking all the time about the creativity. When the stories are all ready, then it comes out like this. I do get writer's block once in a while, but that time, you know, I normally don't like to write 2 books in a year. I always like to write 1 book and stop it. Because if you write successively 2 books, then they will resemble each other. So if you write a children's story first year, next year adult book, third year is mythology, then come again children's book, so that, you know, mind will be more creative. It is just like a land, you know. If you have a farm land and if you sow the same thing every year, the fertile land will diminish. So 1 year we make sugarcane, next year I make wheat, third year I will plant seed for rice, and fourth year again sugarcane. Same way I follow regarding the fertile land of my mind. Okay, so writer's blocks rarely I get because I change the crops. But when I get that time, I don't write. I don't insist. I don't pressurize my mind. I will do a lot more foundation work all the time. Think about foundation all the time. Then the block opens by itself.
That's That's great, ma'am. We've learned a lot from you from today's just 1 hour session. But since we don't have, we would love to continue talking to you, but since we don't have much time, we would like to move on. And it's been wonderful.
I will tell you better one thing.
Yes, ma'am.
You always, you know, I like to talk to children because you are the next generation. You are a rising sun. I'm a setting sun. Whatever experience I have, I want to share with you people. That's a kind of philanthropy also. So what I want to tell you people, 1 second, hold on. What I want to tell you is, every year you call me, if I'm free, I will come.
That's wonderful, ma'am.
Every year you call me. Call me if I'm free, I'm available, I will come. I will never say no.
Yes.
That's great. Thank you so much, ma'am.
At least I can do. See, I always feel. Only 1 second. Nange Jagdishan phone again kelkoli because I'm in a session, I can't come out. I want to tell you one thing. This is what I have seen and I have experienced. Going away from roots is not easy, particularly your parents' generation. You are young, leaving your parents, grandparents, you know, your atmosphere, even your hometown, your food, your restaurants, your cousins. Then you go to another country where you really do not know anybody. Then you start making friendship. Like, you know, a planted tree is uprooted and again rooted in a different place. It takes time and you feel homesick. Whatever said and done, your parents feel a lot more than you. Lot more than you, because they have grown up and they have come. Whereas you are growing up here. So you have a lot of Japanese friends, but they don't have like that. So when people are uprooted and planted again, okay, we should make them comfortable as much as possible. And I feel I should do that. It's a great social work to make them to feel at home with my own Indian English. Okay, with my small vocabulary, giving my experience is also a kind of giving a pat on their back. Look, my dear fellow human beings, you have gone and brought India's name up. Little bit I can do service to you is to talk to you whenever both of us have time. So I always would like to do. Whenever I get 5,000 invitation in a year, but I always tell, if the invitation from Anivasi Bharatiya, that means people who, NRI, not for the money I'm talking. People who are away from my country, they are first preference because I have a duty towards them to talk to them. My own people, I will talk to them sometime later.
That's so heartwarming, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay. Yeah. I always do it people who are away from the roots. Okay.
Ma'am, we look forward to interacting with you again. But
no
now,
problem.
Thank you, Sanna. Now, as we proceed to the end of today's event, I would like to call upon Adhya and Joanne once again. Over to you, Joanne.
Thank you, Kizuna and Saurav. Thank you, ma'am. It has been an absolutely mesmerizing session.
Because Japanese are extremely, extremely punctual about time, and they care a lot. So we can't go on extending. You can't go on expanding. See, I come from a small town, and in our town, you know, we listen to Hindustani music, okay? And the alap, you go on expanding and expanding. There is no end for that. So our sessions will start after dinner, okay? We come and sit there, and Bhairavi will come only at 6 in the morning. We go on expanding. Out of that, he must have sung about 7 to 8 ragas, not more than that. Can you imagine? But you can't do that beautiful expansion in a highly systematic society like Japan. Okay, tell me now.
Honestly, it feels like too good to be true to be actually having a chance to talk with you and interact with you. So thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
And it's been absolutely wonderful to see our classmates also interact with you. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Beta.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks.
So now I'd like to hand it over to our librarian, Mr. Samuel, for the vote of thanks.
Okay. I think I must have crossed time. I'm so sure. Yes or no? Tell me. No? Then I become like Japanese now.
Hello.
No problem at all.
Not at all.
Okay. Yes, Samuel ji. Namaste.
Hello.
Namaste.
Namaskar.
Namaskar.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Yeah.
Well, good afternoon to you from Tokyo and to everyone who has spared some time to join us in this session. We would like to express our most sincere gratitude. Thank you very much for having accepted our invitation and having accepted to be part of this event. It's been amazing. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I am sure I speak in behalf of everyone, parents, teachers, and students, that today's interaction with you has actually sparked and kindled the love for books and stories in every single one of us. So for that, I want to say thank you, Dani and Vatagadu.
Gozaimashita.
Arigato
gozaimashita. Arigato gozaimashita. Thank you.
And I also would like to take this opportunity briefly to thank the whole team formed by incredible colleagues without whom this would have never been possible. So to all of you, a heartfelt thank you. And ma'am, just one thing I want to tell you before I finish this is that I can say that from now on, I won't ever forget about your birthday, because we both happen to share our birthdays on the same day.
19th August.
Yes.
Okay. Because 9 + 1 makes 10, and they're always lucky people.
Exactly. Yeah. So I thought just to share that with you. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Really do you have it. Books of Thank mine you. In your library? Do you have books of mine in your library?
Yes, of course. Even I have some books that I bought when I went to Mumbai 2 years ago, and I bought some books of you. So actually we've been reading your books this week.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Have a nice time and sayonara. Okay. Bye.